Right, I'm quite excited and happy to do this video because being in the industry for quite a while, I've got quite a bit of knowledge on vinyl turntables. I've been DJing for quite a long time, actually. Before CD players, laptop and controllers, all you had was vinyl turntables. And even before I had a set of Technics SL1200, I had some dodgy belt-driven decks that jumped all over the place, and it was a bit like sort of being on a boat, especially when people were dancing, because you're trying to hold everything and stopping the needles jumping and the records jumping and God knows what. But of course, if you could afford, which eventually I was able to afford a set of Technics, I was in heaven. So this video is going to be quite in-depth, believe me. Now, I haven't got these two turntables plugged in, there's no need. But I have used them both. I have used this one here from Reloop. This is the RP 7000 Mark II. And over here, there is the Technics SL1200 Mark II. Both are direct drive, which means that the top of the turntable itself, the platter, is half of the motor. Without the top, it ain't gonna go anywhere. There's no actual moving parts. Well, there is. There's the top of the turntable, but you don't have a motor attached to a belt that then in turn is attached to the turntable, because the turntable itself at the top is part of the motor. This is the direct drive philosophy. And I believe the only reason Technics ruled the DJ industry for many years because they had the patent on the direct drive turntable. So, right, let's get straight down to it. Now, here is a turntable from Reloop, RP 7000 Mark II, direct drive. Over there is the industry standard Technics SL1200 Mark II. Of course, it has been superseded by other models from Technics, but that is one of the most sought after turntables because it's the original sort of club deck. In other words, during the 80s, if you were booked to work in a nightclub and you turned up with your record, and you went into the DJ booth and you saw a couple of Garrard belt-driven turntables, you had pretty much all the right in the world to turn around, go home and demand all your money back, because they were pretty much like the pioneer CDJs that you would expect to see in most nightclubs now. But I want to give you an analogy, first of all. And I need you to bear this in mind through this video because it's hyper important. Let's say you have oodles of money and you're a classic car fanatic. In other words, you've got an old school BMW or an Audi or an Alfa Romeo and you have a mechanic with you at all times. Alternatively, a Porsche. But they are old versions, old models from the 70s and 80s. Now, even though they may be classics and they're hard to get, they're very expensive. they're also very expensive to fix and to find parts for. Now that is the same with the Technics SL1200 Mark II, because they don't make them anymore. So it's getting more and more difficult to find the parts. So by definition, if you want to buy a Technics SL1200 Mark II, there are still brand new ones around, I'm sure, in sealed boxes, but you're going to pay a premium for them. Not only that, if something goes wrong, you're going to pay a premium for the parts. On the other hand, the Reloop, relatively new turntable, and parts should be relatively inexpensive because they're still about. So you must think about that. So the analogy there is you're driving around in your two-year-old car and all of a sudden the engine falls out. Well, you can go and get another engine from, like, the shop down the road. On the other hand, in your prized 35-year-old BMW and the engine falls out, walk away. Right, so, let's have a look. Now, the Technics there, slip mat, look at that, classic Mockham slip mat. I'm going to take the platter off, and there is half of the motor. Now, that is just a magnet. I believe it's an electromagnet, so as soon as you put the power on, of course, that turns. So that is what the platter looks like on a Technics SL1200 Mark II. And let me just make sure I've got, I don't like putting my back to the camera, but I've got to sit that on correctly. Again, when placing the platter on a turntable, you don't want to put it in any angle whatsoever. The best way to do it is have a bird's eye view straight down and place it directly on top, not at any angle. Take the slip mat off the reloop. Now, this is a standard slip mat with the reloop, and that is a nice slip mat. It's firm, very thin, and I've given it a go, and yes, it definitely does slip. I'm going to take the platter off the reloop now, and there it is, pretty much exactly the same. But the only difference here is that the top of the reloop, the 7000, is very flat. So there's a slight difference there. Underneath the Technics, you've got a plastic cover with all the internal workings, whereas on the reloop, you haven't. You probably do have to go underneath and start pulling it apart, which I am not going to do. So let's place that back on top of the deck. So I will have the camera closer very soon. So what I'll do, I'll give you a demonstration, and then afterwards I'll put the camera closer to both turntables. Now then, if we look at the reloop, on the left-hand side we have our on-off, start-stop, and we've also got a reverse button. Now, we do not have that with the Technics. Pretty much exactly the same here. We have on-off, start-stop, 33 and 45, at very much exactly the same position. But what the Technics doesn't have, and the reloop does have, is 78 RPM. So first of all, if you press 33 and a third, okay, bear that in mind, because what that means, 45 and 33, 78, it means the revolutions per minute, RPM. In other words, in every minute, 60 seconds, the turntable will turn at either 33 and a third revolutions in a minute, 45 revolutions in a minute, or 78 revolutions in a minute on the RP. On the other hand, on the Technics, it will only do 33 and a third revolutions per minute and 45 revolutions per minute. So, do you want to go 78? Well, for effects, maybe yes you do. Now, the reloop also has a reverse mode. Press the reverse button and it will start to go backwards. Now, having used that, it is spot on the money. It's very fast. You don't have any lag. It doesn't sort of seem to slow down and then go... It's a bit... It's almost like it's turning, stop, and reverse mode. So there's a lot of power in this motor. In fact, there's more power in the reloop than there is in the Technics, which I will explain very shortly. So that is this area here. Now, a lot of DJs who do scratch turntablism like to put their decks in what's called battle mode. So what we do is we turn the turntable 90 degrees. So now the head shell is away from you. And if I do that with the Technics, which of course I can do, what we have here is another difference. With the Technics, we have got a small compartment there where you'll have your center part for example, 7-inch singles. If you've got the center missing out of 7-inch single, you place that in the on the spindle, place your piece of vinyl without the with a larger hole, let's say, in the middle, and then that of course would fit over the center part. But this was a handmade one. I do have the original in there somewhere in this room somewhere. And it's silver, it's actually aluminium. So I'm just going to leave that there. Whereas on the 7000, we have another start-stop button. Now again, that's a great feature because it means for turntablists, if, let's say, you have, for example, let's say I have an RP7000 on my right-hand side and one on the left-hand side over here and a mixer in the middle, it means that I have actually got start stops very close to the middle, or should I say very close to the mixer itself. So instead of reaching over and reaching over, they are there straight away. Okay, so again, mixer in the middle. If I did only have the one start stop on the right hand side, I'd have to go directly across to the right. On the other hand though, with the deck on the left hand side, it would be very close to me. So instead, what they've thought is, well, why don't we have two start stops? So they're going to be right next to the mixer, which is a great feature for scratch turntablists. So I'm just going to move that back to its original position. Now, something here as well. Let's imagine you're in a room and you don't have much space. Then by all means, set your turntables up in battle mode for any reason. But if you are generally a house drum and bass mixing DJ and you're not really into turntablism, I would say you're a bit of an idiot if you put them into battle mode, because you're there and you're trying to select the speed and you're moving your arm back. Just there. This is how they should be if you're a DJ who likes to do basic mixing. If you look in any nightclub pictures from years gone by, very rarely will you see decks that way, as I showed you earlier on, in a normal sort of nightclub, unless of course you are a hip-hop DJ. Right, so that's that. Now, on the Technics, and this is one of those things that annoyed me. I had to change it about two or three times, and I mean, it was like, I'm going to have a week off now, not to go on holiday, not to go shopping, but to change the Pulite on the Technics SL1200. Now, there it is. Press it down and press a small little button to the right of it, and it pops up. And a brand new Technics, it was quite good because it just slowly rose, press it down, but the older it gets, it seems to be a bit wobbly, and you know, it's sometimes it shoots up and sometimes it comes halfway up and says, sod you, I just want to stay down. You had to pull the damn thing up. That's not the bad part. The worst part is when the light goes out and it stops working. Now, that is a tiny little bulb. You'd think, no problems. But to change that bulb, you had to completely pull apart the entire turntable. It was an absolute bloody nightmare. I hated it. Got to the stage where it was like, well, what's the point? It was actually far better for you just to put a torch there or just leave it instead of spending about 5 years changing it. But guess what? The RP7000 Mark II has got one of those. Look at that. Now that is its Pulite, and it's a basic RCA connection. And all I'm going to do, I'm going to plug that in there. Now, how genius is that? Because if it goes wrong, what do? You take it out. Do I want to fix that? No. Probably the best thing to do is to throw it away and get another one. Alternatively, you might be able to unscrew that. But to be quite honest, for the sake of X amount, get a new one. So look at that. That is genius. Pop it in there, and you can also turn it in any direction you want. Whereas the Technics, it was facing in one direction and one direction only. So that's a big thumbs up, definitely, for the RP7000. Right, so I'm just going to put that... No, in fact, I'll leave that there for in a bit when I do a close-up. Now, I'm going to take the arms off both of the turntables. I'm going to lift the armrests up and just move the entire arm of the deck into the centre so we can now have a look at the pitch area. Now, this is where it gets quite interesting, because the Technics has plus and minus 8%. That is it. Also, what it has is when you put the pitch into the center position, it clicks into position. Now that, excuse me. No, I'm fine. I suffer a little bit from asthma and I've just been on a bike ride, and it's great because I'm coughing up all the shit. There you go. Before you ask. I know. Okay. Calm down. Right. So the Technics, when you put the pitch into the centre, it clicks into position. That's because there's a tiny little metal ball attached to, or and behind that is a spring and a slot. So when you get to the centre position, the little ball just lodges into that slot and the spring keeps it in place. So what you've got this sort of awkward part in the centre where, if you've used Technics before and you're in the mix and you're fine-tuning it and you find that the track you're mixing in, the position of the pitch is directly at the centre, then quite often you had to either slow down or speed up the track that was playing, so you could then beat match the one that you're bringing in a position where it wasn't close to the centre, because sometimes it was very awkward to get that at a precise, let's say, BPM. On the other hand, with the RP7000, we don't have that. It is just a smooth transition all the way from plus to minus 6%. But also what they've got is a reset button. So anywhere, any position that the pitch is in, you can just press that reset button and it will go to the original speed of the deck, whether it be 33 and a third, 45 or 78. So that is a great feature. Now also above there, which is towards the minus position, we have two buttons, plus and minus 8 and plus and minus 16. So it's a little bit like a CDJ, which quite often you have 6, 10, 16 and wide, whereas here you have 8 and 16. So that means you can increase or decrease by 8% or 16%. So for all the idiots out there, including me, that's what it is. Thank you. Thank you for telling me. I'll just tell myself now. Okay. It means that if you've got a track that's 100 BPM and you're at 8%, you will increase it by 8%. So the track will no longer be at 100 BPM. All the way up here, it will now be at 108 BPM. Move it away from you and it will now go to 92 BPM. Now that is exactly the same with the Technics, but that's where the Technics stops. On the other hand, the 7000, you can reduce it by 16. So you get to 16% plus 116. Take away 16 from 100 is, oh my God, my maths, 84. 90, yeah, thank God for that. 84 BPM. Right, 84 and 6 is, yeah, 84. Ah, sorry, right. Should have learnt maths, shouldn't I? Yes, okay. Right, so again, a great feature. But a word of warning here. Now, this is the same with the Technics and the same with the 7000. In fact, this is a word of warning for any vinyl turntable that you use. When you're doing a mix, if you are going to start mixing tracks in above or below about 3%, then you need to watch your keys, because you will start increasing or decreasing semitones based on if you reduce the pitch too much or you increase it too much. So this is where your ear comes in big time, all right? And again, if you're using virtual vinyl with a program, you don't have to worry about that so long as you enable key lock, also known as master tempo. Right, so let's have a think about it. Now, the Technics, I'm not sure exactly about the torque. Now, first of all, what is torque? Let me explain it in, an easy way of understanding. Let's imagine you are holding onto a rope, and the other end of that rope is someone on, let's say, a go-kart, and they're trying to pedal away and you're holding that rope and you're stopping them from moving away. Now, there's a lot of force with them pulling and you're pulling. You're trying to pull them back. So if you imagine if the Technics was on now and I had my finger on the turntable with the motor trying to turn, I would be pulling that back. I'd be stopping it from moving. And I would need a certain amount of force to stop that from moving. So based on the power of that motor would also be based on, or shall I start again? Based on the power of that motor would mean I would have to put a certain amount of pressure on the side of the turntable to stop it from moving. So if the motor wasn't very powerful, I wouldn't have to put much pressure on the side of the turntable. On the other hand, the more powerful the motor, the more pressure I'd have to put on it to stop it from moving. But with the Technics, it's only got one amount of torque. You can't increase or decrease it. On the other hand, you can with the 7000. So we have two dials. I will explain about the one on the right in a bit, but the one on the left is for your torque. So why would you want that? Now, again, I've been using turntables for a very long time. And with the reduced amount of torque, that would be great for DJs who like to mix house music and techno and trance. In other words, you're not a scratch turntablist. You just like to do these puristic mixes for 7 hours long playing house music. Now, a lot of DJs, what they will do is while they're in the mix and they're moving the pitch, let's say they want to slow the track down a little bit. Now, you know, on CD players, you've got what's known as pitch bend, a plus and a minus. You press the plus and the track will seem to speed up a little bit. But as soon as you take your finger off the plus, it will go back to its original speed. Alternatively, if you press the minus, it will start to slow down. While you have your finger on the minus button, take your finger off, it will go back up to the original speed based on where the pitch is. This is sort of the same here, because with a low to medium torque setting, what you can do is you can put your finger on the side of the turntable. And again, there is a technique to this. And while you're doing that, you're actually starting to slow the whole track down, and based on your pressure will of course determine if the track gets slower or even slower or slower. It won't get faster because it will only be as fast as the pitch is set, but you will be able to get it slower. Now, on the other hand, what some DJs do is this. They will turn the spindle in an almost like an anti-clockwise motion, and that as well will slow the turntable down. On the other hand, what some DJs will do as well is they'll spin it in a clockwise motion, which will speed it up. And also some DJs do this. They seem to like just move the turntable, give it a nudge, a tiny nudge. But there you have to be careful because, you know, the track playing could sound a bit like... Right, I hope you get that. But let's imagine you're a scratch turntablist DJ. I would be then turning the torque dial more towards 3, 4, 5 o'clock. Now, what that will do, it will increase the torque. So going back to our little guy on a go-kart and you're holding the rope, he's on a go-kart, but he's no longer using his legs. He's got a powerful motor. Yes, this is a motorized go-kart, petrol driven, and he's going to pull your bloody arm off, isn't he? So that's pretty much what happens here. I've tried it. And you go on the low torque setting, and it's not dissimilar to the torque setting of the Technics. That's it. You put it on the high one, and it's like, my God, what's going on here? This is on bloody steroids. So it's great for scratch turntablists, simply because needle on the record, you're holding the record. The worst thing in the world, which does happen depending on humidity and the, for example, the slip mat you've got. But quite often with a lot of other turntables, including the Technics, you put your hand on the record, which is on top of a slip mat, the platter starts to slow down. But it does not with the 7000, because there's that much torque there. It's like, is that all you've got, mate? Give me some more. So a great feature. Now, on the, where are we now? On the 7000 also, we have a break adjust. Now, what that will do, and again, this is only the first video on, actually, this is a comparison, but I will be using the 7000 a lot more in future videos. Now, on the 7000, we have the break adjust. Now, this is a great feature, for example, if you want to press stop and have the record just slow down naturally, like so. So with that dial set to the 7 o'clock position, you press start, it will start straight away. You press stop, it will stop within less than a second. The more you move that clockwise, when you press stop, it will start to slow down slower. So let's say, for example, you turn that all the way to the 5 o'clock position, you press the start stop, or you press start stop once the deck is already, of course, the deck's already going. And then it's almost like, if you can imagine, here we go, here's an example. A 1, 2, 3 o'clock, 4 o'clock, rock, a 5, 6, 7 o'clock. Right, yeah, I hope you get that. Okay, so there. reason I love doing this. Oh, God, I am nuts. I know. Don't care. I love it. Right. Right, so let's have a look. I'm going to put the little tone arms down, put the locks on the actual arms themselves, and take off these counterweights. Right, so Technics will be on the left. Sorry, right, which is your left, right. All right, I don't know, because you're looking at me and I'm looking at you. Right, that is the Technics counterweight, and that is the counterweight for, that's right, yeah, that's it, yeah. That Technics, and, God, they are so similar. No, hold on, no. Shit, that's right, yeah. That's the, I took those off there, yeah, so that's right. Technics counterweight and the RP, they're pretty much identical. There's practically no, in fact, I can't see any difference at all. No, can I see any difference? Absolutely not at all. Except one slightly bigger, but very little difference. Okay, so let's put those back on there, like so. Turn them on. Also as well, just to let you know, you can see a bunch of numbers here. Just make sure that the numbers are facing towards you, not the other way around like that. Okay, so I'm going to put that on there. Now, both of the turntables, the housing for the arm, the actual design is very similar, whereas the Technics is more a dull sort of silver look. The 7000 is more of a machined, shiny look. It looks a little bit more plush, I'll be honest with you. But from a workings point of view, they're both identical. It's a similar construction, similar design. But again, best thing to do is if I put the camera a little bit closer later on, then, you know, you yourself, you can have a closer look and you'll see that there is actually very little difference. Now, on both decks, there's a small lever just to the right of the counterweight. And the idea there is you move the lever and then you're able then to increase and decrease the height of the entire tone arm housing. Now, there's good reason for that. That's because, for example, different slip mats are different thickness, and the objective is to always make sure that the tone arm itself is level with the platter. So the platter's flat, the tone arm should be like that. You do not want the tone arm facing down or up. And of course, that will happen if you don't set the level of the complete housing correctly. So that's really, that's another demonstration in itself, because that's all about setting up the turntable correctly. But this video is about giving a comparison between the two. Right, so I'm going to move the turntables now so we can see the back. And once I've done this, then we'll have a quick close-up. So let's just turn that around there. Now, the Technics has an internal wired-in RCA. There's also a small lead there, which is your earth cable. Now, have you ever set up a set of turntables or been to a gig and great light show, great mixer, a couple of Technics, great PA, but all you can hear is this this humming sound? It's probably because they've forgotten to plug in the, or plug the earth cable into the mixer. That's very important. That will stop any humming, any background noise. So with the Technics, what I have found, I'm sure people will agree, is that over time, your RCA cables start to not wear away, but they come loose, and maybe the left side, you've got to fiddle it in with a mixer and, you know, it cuts in and out. That's because over time, the cables inside here probably just wear away and you lose connections. Whereas the RP, it comes with, guess what? It comes with one of these, which is an RCA to RCA. Attached to it is an earth cable. So this is a great feature. What this means is that, you know what? You can plug that in, plug that to your mixer or vice versa. And if something goes wrong with this, well, it's no big deal. You just get another RCA cable and get a small, tiny, thin cable, which can be used for the earth, and you're good to go. So that is a great feature. Now, also with the Technix, it does have, like the RCA cable, it has an internal power cable. Now, I have never had any problems with the power cable, but maybe if that starts going wrong, the only way of fixing it is definitely not if, for example, you have a problem here or there, not to cut it and just like gaffer tape it up. Very dodgy. No, what you would have to do is just, oh, look at this bare wire. Oh, don't start me, please. You'd have to unplug the entire deck and wire it in. Whereas the 7000 has got, it's a figure of eight. Okay, so, right. I'm gonna leave it at that. Okay, you've got here the connection for the earth, RCA, and also at the back here, there is a small area where you can set the power supply, but I would have thought that would already be set based on the country you're in. 240 or 115 volts. You do have similar with the Technix, but you lift the platter up and there is a switch in there. But if you bought the Technix from your local shop down the road, I wouldn't mess with that because by all rights, it should be set anyway. Right, so I'm going to turn this around now. Turn the Technix around. Sorry, RP around. And now I'll turn the Technix around. There you go. Right. Okay, so let's take the camera off the stand and let's have a closer look. Okay. So both of them as well have got what's known as Concord cartridges. Now, I would highly recommend you get these sorts of cartridges because if you buy a box standard head shell and then attach, let's say, an old school Stanton cartridge, 500AL or something like that, what you've got to do is you've got to set up the, first of all, you've got to fit the cartridge, also make sure it's in the correct position, and there's a lot of faffing around. Whereas Concord style cartridges like this, all you do is you plug it into the head shell and it's all set. So great. All right, let's just take that off there. Oh, thank goodness I've still got the plastic cover on. I recommend you do that actually while the turntable isn't being used. As you could see then, it just hit the side of the turntable. And what you don't want to happen is accidentally do that and then damage the needle, also known as the styli, because that's a small tiny diamond attached to a very, very thin piece of metal. If that bends, it may still work, but you're not going to get true good fidelity stereo sound. Okay, so here's our reset button. And if you look and listen, nice smooth action. Technix, let's just move that off there, lift that, have a listen. You can hear that click. Okay, I mean, don't get me wrong, Technix are great turntables, but they are kind of old school now. That is old school. This is new school. This is something that, again, is built to last. Now, with the ReLoop RP7000, like the Technix, it is not a toy. It's not... ReLoop haven't thought, let's just design and make a turntable and hope for the best. No, there's a lot of thought gone into this. It feels solid, it's chunky, it's heavy. Like the Technix, it's a piece of metal. It's not a little piece of plastic and a couple of shiny bits and sod it. No, it's solid. It's absolutely solid, robust. Okay, so if we have a look at the top of the arm, you can see there, it's pretty much exactly the same as the Technix. And again, start stop, same with the ReLoop, but of course we have reverse here. Now, people have always asked me, what are these for here? Now, when this turntable is turning, if you can see where my finger is, we have a small dot, a large one, and two smaller ones at the top. So basically what this means, without going into great detail, when the dots in relation to the dots here are stationary, it means that you're going at a certain percentage of plus speed or minus speed. So for example, the lower dot, when that's stationary, you've actually reduced the speed, the RPM, by 3.3. The second one from the top, you've increased by 3.3. And the one at the top, you've increased by 7.2. But the middle one, the big one, when that is stationary, you are at the original speed based on if you're 33, 45 or 78. Okay, start, stop. Nice, good feel to them as well. Very similar. Again, the actual platters themselves, they are almost identical. But there's good reason for that, because it's a vinyl turntable. Records are round. You're not going to get the top of a turntable that's square. I don't think so. I mean, maybe someone would make one, but it would look a little bit silly. All right, so there you go. There is a comparison between the two decks. So I'm just going to put the camera back on the stand and go back to my first explanation. So you've decided to get yourself a classic car, and you want to get yourself a classic BMW, and you want to drive it around every day, and you want to impress the neighbours. Well, by all means, do it. By all means, carry on. It's going to serve you proud. But bear in mind that if something goes wrong, it's going to cost you a lot in parts. Bearing in mind that if something goes wrong and you need a certain part, you may be finding you're sitting around waiting for a long time to get that part because there may be very few around. Now let's put that analogy on the Technics. It's a great turntable. It works. But if something goes wrong, for example, you need a counterweight, you need the tone arm, you need the pitch control, you may find it's very difficult to get the parts, or they may be very expensive. On the other hand, the RP7000 Mark II, it's still around. It should be quite inexpensive to get the parts. And it is pretty much exactly the same as the Technics, except it does have more modern day features, all right? Now, thank you for watching. If you want any more information on both of these turntables, there will be links in the description. So, big it up. And wiki wiki, keep that vinyl spinning. Practice and enjoy. Thank you.